Okay. So thank you for meeting with me.
Oh my gosh, it's my absolute pleasure.
Is this your first Y'all Fest?
It is.
And what do you think so far?
Oh, I think it's great. I've had such a good time. I had a great signing. The keynote this morning was super fun. Yes. I moderated my first panel, which was exciting. And it's just been fun to like see all these people. It's like we've totally taken over this town, which is amazing.
If you had to pick one thing, what have you enjoyed the most so far?
I feel like maybe the keynote. It was really fun, and it was really, it was like, I felt like it was a fun way to like kick off the panel, the day, so that was great.
Okay, getting into the books. So most of your books take place over the summer, but Save the Date is in one weekend.
Yes.
How did that affect your writing process?
A lot. So Save the Date was the most challenging book I've ever written, which is funny because it's this like fun like romp, so it's odd that this was like the one that was like the most trouble. But I think the problem was the last three books I'd written had all taken place over 3 months, and I sort of had that rhythm kind of very baked in, and it was very conscious when I said I wanted to write a book that takes place over a limited time period, because I could feel myself getting very familiar with the 3 month time span. I didn't want to keep, you never want to keep doing the same thing over and over again.
I was actually at a signing where you said my next book is going to be in a weekend.
Yeah. God. I was so young, so innocent, so thinking I knew how to do it. So I consciously wanted to do something else, but I didn't realize that would mean I had to change the way I thought about my writing process. Like, so I sort of hit up against the reality of, because normally I sort of find my books as I write them, which is easier when you have like a longer time span, and also a time span that has delineations. Like, I was always sort of knowing, okay, we're at 4th of July, we're about halfway through. Like, it has these markers, and a long time span also gives you the ability to say, 3 weeks passed and not much happened, but then stuff started happening again. And like, when it's so short, I found that I was starting, my first few drafts were 690 and 720 pages respectively, and the second draft was in an attempt to make it much shorter, and it just couldn't do it, because I was sort of doing what I always did, which was like, oh, I'll find the story as I go. But when it's so short, that meant I was kind of, I didn't know
every single moment.
Literally, something. Every single moment, every single bagel run. I was telling everything because I didn't know what was important yet. So it was so overwritten. It didn't have the kind of structure it needed. So it was a big learning process. And I feel like with the third draft, my editor and I really were like, okay, we need to, let's just work on structure. Let's just like figure out what is happening, when, on what day, and what characters are coming and going. And so it was interesting because I knew I wanted to write a different kind of book, but I didn't sort of think about the fact I can't write this like it's a 3 month book. And so it was a big challenge. I'm really happy with how it turned out, but it was like, this was the hardest, it was the biggest challenge, just because it was forcing me to come at it in a different way.
Thank you.
Sorry, that was maybe longer than I
thought. No, it's fine. Sticking with writing process for a moment, what comes first, the characters or the story?
I guess it depends on which book. Usually I have like a premise, and then from there the characters come, and the characters really tend to drive the story. Usually in my books, Save the Date is different because that's very action driven. The characters are very reactive to a lot of what's happening, but normally in my books there's like an inciting incident, something that kicks it off, but then it's mostly just about character development within that. So it's always sort of some premise. It's like, okay, the daughter of a congressman who is involved in a scandal and her summer changes, or a girl's friend leaves her a list. But then it's sort of, that's the only kind of plot thing that happens, and then it's like, okay, who is this character and how does she change? So it's like a little bit of a marriage of the two, but it's usually not story driven. It's much more character driven in this circumstance that's been kicked off in the beginning.
So you often have Easter eggs from your previous books, and they're so much fun to find, as long as you're reading the books in order.
That's the thing. People have been very confused sometimes.
Yes.
And I'm like, you gotta.
I read your first three out of order.
Oh, no.
And I at least, like, one was, like, obvious enough that I picked up that it was somebody I should know.
Okay.
So then when I read the other one, I was like, okay, now I see.
But I'm glad they weren't all so obvious. Like, I'm glad that you could read the other ones and not pick up on there was someone you should have known. Because that's the goal. It's like, I hate when I'm reading a book and I'm like, I'm supposed to know who this is. I don't know who this is. And now I feel like I'm not part of the club.
I think it's also because, like, I also write. So part of it is, like, me being like,
oh,
I don't
like
think I would have been included.
Yeah. Oh, okay. You're like, why are we spending this time talking about this random person?
Exactly.
It's like in a movie when someone, like, lingers on someone. It's like, well, they're going to be important.
Exactly. And it kind of ruins the reading experience sometimes. Because I'm like, you wouldn't mention that if it wasn't important.
Totally.
So would you ever consider, or do you have any plans to write a full-out sequel for any of your standalones?
I don't.
Okay.
I kind of feel like, I mean, the thing that stories need is growth slash conflict, and it's, I feel like trilogies and series work great when you plan them that way. Mm-hmm. I feel like when something is written as a standalone, you can all, we've all read those, where it's like, they're like, okay, now a sequel, and then they have to, like, break up the couple, or they have to, it's like, if, like, one felt very organic, I would do it, but it's kind of like, okay, if these people learned these lessons and changed in this way, then, like, what's the next thing? And it's like, I never want conflict for the sake of conflict. Like, I never want to, like, break someone up just so they can get back together again. So I feel like my books don't really lend themselves to it. If I ever, like, thought of something from the beginning, it's like, okay, this is where the first book ends, and this is where she goes in the second, and this is where she goes in the third. I feel like that's a different situation. But right now, no plans to do that.
Because of your answer to that one, I'm going to jump to this one.
Okay.
And this is a question that might break some hearts.
Okay.
We'll see. So, you're writing about high school romance.
Yes.
Which, in real life, doesn't tend to last. Right. So,
nor should it.
Right. So, which of the couples do you think will or won't actually make it?
I mean, it was... I liked in writing The Unexpected Everything, putting, like, I think Palmer and Tom are going to get married. Like, it was like, and in, there's like an extra, there's an extra thing in Save the Date, where Andy goes to, Charlie goes to interview Andy at Yale, and she, when she's there, it's like, Palmer's there, and Tom's there, and Clark's there, and so, and you find out that Palmer and Tom are, like, engaged to be engaged, and it's like, from the beginning, I was like, oh, this is that couple, like, in high school, who, like, find each other freshman year, and are just, like, bananas for each other, and you know they're gonna get married and have, like, four kids, and, like, it was just, like, but for my main characters, it is that thing of sort of, like, you want people to go and have, like, other experiences and, like, life experiences, and, I mean, I feel like, I mean, I could see Andy and Clark, because I feel like he was so sort of mature already, and, like, I could see them making it if they, like, broke up for, like, 5 years and then, like, got back together again. You know what I mean? Like, had other experiences, like, allowed themselves to go do other things. No one's gonna like this answer. But I feel like Andy and Clark were some of my most adult protagonists.
Definitely.
In a way. Like,
I agree.
She'd been, like, taking care of her. She was very young in some ways, but in other ways, she'd been sort of taking care
she'd
of herself for a long time.
She'd been forced to grow
time.
Up, and yeah.
She really kind of figured out what she wanted. He was also had been forced to grow up very early, so I feel like they were sort of coming at it from a very, you could almost put them, like, their two sort of circumstances could almost be people in their 20s. Like, I feel like they were kind of, they figured more out than a lot of people had in that I write about. So, yeah. But I kind of stopped the movie. I don't necessarily know what happens, but,
okay.
But yeah.
Why have you chosen to write under two different names?
So I'm not really doing it anymore.
Okay.
I had any new Katie Finn projects on the docket.
Okay.
I like to say she's on a beach in Tahiti somewhere, you know, having fun. So it started because of circumstance. I was working at Scholastic and in grad school, and literally, like, was in a meeting and we started talking about, like, a book about the internet. This was in 2007, so it was, like, an exciting thing to write a book about the internet. And so my boss was literally like, do you want to write a book about the internet? And I was like, yes, please. And I turned into this weird, like, mystery thing. But I was already writing Amy and Roger at that point, and I knew it was not gonna be, like, a paperback book about the internet. So I was like, let's, like, have a way to separate these. Like, I want my debut to be, like, my real debut, as opposed to, like, this paperback original thing that, like, so my middle name's Katie Finn, so it doesn't feel like it's, like, a fake name, it just feels like it's my, like, my middle two names. And so I wrote that series, and that was so fun, and then a few years later I had the idea for the Broken Hearts and Revenge series, and that was one I thought of from the beginning. I was like, oh, this is three books, like, this is, like, we get to one place at the end of one,
right.
We get to one place at the end of two, we get to finish at the end of three. But I was like, oh, this is so not a Morgan Matson book, this is, like, Hampton's Revenge, like, Mistaken Identity, it's like a soap opera. Like, I was like, oh, it could be a Katie Finn book. So it's like, I feel like it was more like, those are super plot driven, they're super twisty and always a little bit weird and heightened. Whereas I feel like the Morgan Matsons get a little more granular and, like, dig into, like, real sort of, like,
right.
emotions, and it's much less kind of twisty turny plot stuff.
Bringing me right to my next question. there's often a deeper theme in your books than just the simple romance.
Uh-huh.
How do you find the balance between the romance aspect of it and those other themes?
I feel like I always want my books to feel like life, which is one of the things I was really fighting for in Unexpected Everything the most, is that I wanted it to have the friendship, the family, and the romance, and like that no one thing drove the story, and no one thing was less important, and they were all equally important, mm-hmm. because that's what life feels like to me. It's like, even when you're like head over heels in love with someone, it's like your friends don't disappear, your family doesn't go away. It's like everything's always happening at the same time. And so I kind of try and achieve that balance of like, yes, there's this guy and he's super cute and you have a crush, but like the rest of your life doesn't stop. And like it's just like part of mm-hmm. the thing.
Okay. Do you have a favorite couple to write?
That's so hard. I had a lot of fun with Andy and Clark. I feel like because I got to write the most of their relationship, like as opposed to just like, I like this person and now we're gonna kiss on the last page. Like it was like really got to like dig into them being a couple and them being together. So that was really fun. But I also like, there's like, Charlie and Bill is exciting because it's like a possibility. And it's like, I haven't, like, it's just sort of leaves you with like, I don't know, we'll see. Who knows what could happen there? So I feel like that's always fun to think about.
That was my last question. Thanks again.
Great. Thank you so much for these great questions. Sorry I was so long-winded with some of them.
No, it's fine. I like it that way, actually.
Oh, great. Well then, perfect.